Some positive news on the bid to mend strained ties between the United States and China. Visiting U.S. Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo and her Chinese counterpart Wang Wentao have expressed support for improving trade conditions between the two nations. The commerce chiefs of Washington and Beijing and also expressed optimism about improving communication. But they did not announce any progress on issues involving technology, security, human rights, and other disputes that have plunged relations to their lowest levels in decades. The meeting comes days after Washington approved a $500 million arms sale to Taiwan. The trading resumption of China's Evergrande for the first time since last year is off to a bad start. Now shares of the heavily indebted property developer plunged by as much as 87% on its open this Monday. Its decision to return to trading came as it posted a smaller loss of 39.25 billion yuan in the first half from the 86 billion yuan in the same period last year. It also follows its decision to seek Chapter 15 bankruptcy protection at a court in the United States. Evergrande defaulted in 2021 and has been undertaking an offshore debt restructuring since March. Asian markets kicking off a final trading week of the month higher. Trading in China in focus today as regulators in the world's second largest economy cut in half the stamp duty on stock trading to revive the struggling market and boost investor confidence. One analyst believes, though, the impact of the move could be short-lived. Xi Chen of Shanghai Jianwen Investment sees the rebound lasting for 3 days or even shorter. Taking a look now at the major stock indices in the region, the Shanghai Composite and the Hang Seng up by more than 1% this Monday. The Chinese markets are joined by Japan's Nikkei 225 and the ASX 200. As Australia sees its retail sales climbing month on month in July. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They're pointing to a positive start to the week as investors digest China's move to boost its capital market. Meanwhile, markets in the UK are closed for a public holiday. Over in Wall Street, futures are cautiously higher with investors preparing for several important economic data. That includes preliminary GDP data and unemployment numbers. These reports come on the heels of U.S. Federal Reserve Chief Jerome Powell's speech in Wyoming that the Fed is ready to continue raising rates further to fight inflationary pressures. Now, India has further tightened restrictions on rice exports, setting limits on foreign sales of basmati rice. That is on top of the earlier ban on exports of other rice varieties. Among the new measures announced is a ban on exports of fragrant basmati rice priced below $1,200 per metric ton. New Delhi is citing high inflation, fears of local shortages, and rising food prices for the latest rice export restriction. But according to official data, rice exports from the Asian country have continued to increase with some 7.3 million metric tons so far this year, compared to 6.7 million in the same period last year. Philippine Congressman Ralph Recto urges government to rethink its agriculture strategy. The House Deputy Speaker says the private sector must be allowed to invest in farming. He also calls for a review of a law that limits the ownership of agricultural land to just 5 hectares.
We have to think of agri differently already. The farmers, their children don't want to be farmers anymore. You know how hard it is to plant rice? You have to make them nice. And the only way, you have to get private sector money into agriculture. You cannot rely on government alone. Okay? You need to do more corporate farming.
Okay.
Maybe we should rethink already the limitations that you can only allow 5 hectares of agricultural land. Okay. Let's get a farmer, and I'm very productive. I want to expand my farm from 5 hectares to 10 hectares. By law, I'm not allowed to do that.
Mm-mm.
So, yes, I did file bills to allow this to happen already. Yeah. I think we have to rethink our agriculture strategy.
Now, data from the Treasury Bureau show the Marcos administration's total borrowings climbed 33% to 1.42 trillion pesos during the six-month period. Most of the borrowings came from local sources, which lent over 1 trillion pesos. External borrowings, meanwhile, reached 366.4 billion pesos. Philippine Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno stresses the need for regional cooperation between ASEAN member states to weather shared headwinds, such as monetary policy tightening and geopolitical tensions. Diokno made that remark at the ASEAN Finance Ministers and Central Bank Governors meeting in Indonesia. He says Southeast Asian nations should strengthen the region's surveillance activities and cooperation on macroeconomic policies and enhance regional financial safety nets. In line with this, Diokno welcomed the ASEAN Infrastructure Fund, which harmonizes regional infrastructure financing in Southeast Asia. He says it has already benefited the Philippines as the AIF has funded Davao's public transport modernization project. Philippine officials meet with leaders of the Japan International Cooperation Agency, or JICA, in Tokyo. Cabinet secretaries, led by Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno, NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisakan, and Transport Chief Jaime Bautista, met with JICA President Tanaka Akihiko on the sidelines of the 14th Joint Committee meeting on infrastructure and economic cooperation between Manila and Tokyo. During the meeting, JICA expressed its continued commitment to supporting the Philippines' development agenda and to explore more cooperation on energy and public-private partnerships. Power distributor Meralco has increased the share of renewable energy in its supply portfolio. Meralco said it has contracted 1,880 megawatts of RE capacity from various suppliers, surpassing its initial 1,500 megawatt goal. This is in line with the Energy Department's renewable energy push. Under the DOE's policy, electricity providers are mandated to source a portion of their supply from renewable sources, as the government hopes to convert 35% of the country's energy mix by 2030 and 50% by 2040.
The Marcos administration is urged to extend the validity period of an executive order that has lowered tariffs for some staples. President Marcos, in December 2022, signed the Customs Modernization and Tariff Act, effectively cutting tariff rates on key commodities to address rising prices. It will remain in force until December 31 of this year. The British Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines says it should be extended as it has helped trade between the UK and the Philippines, which last year reached a record high of 2.4 billion pounds, or around $3 billion.
The interest of UK companies to assist in supplying pork and beef to the Philippine market is extremely strong. There will be challenges, but we're confident and we would strongly endorse the extension of EO10. We would obviously recommend that it's extended throughout and continue into obviously 2024. Pork exports from the UK have risen significantly in 2022. It was up to 34,000, up over 34%.
The poll period for the long-delayed village and youth council elections in the Philippines officially underway. In the capital city, Manila, poll officials announced an early cutoff for the filing of certificates of candidacy after they were overwhelmed with the volume of aspirants. The districts of Tondo and Sampaloc will only entertain candidates who queued in the morning and will no longer accept newcomers this afternoon. Candidates also filed up the Taguig Convention Center. Among those submitting their COCs, there are candidates from Embo Barangays, which were formerly under Makati City's jurisdiction. The Southern Police District said the COC filing in the area remains peaceful. A festive first day of filing of COCs, meanwhile, seen in Mandaue City, Cebu. The local poll office said most of the problems they encountered today were missing documentary stamps, as well as unruly supporters. Officials have requested for a change of venue, saying their office space is not spacious to accommodate hundreds of aspirants. Commissions on Elections Chairman George Garcia reminded candidates not to engage in premature campaigning before the prescribed period from October 19 to 28. A gun ban is also now in force, and COMELEC checkpoints have been set up across the country. The Philippine poll body ramping up efforts to prevent vote buying in the upcoming local elections. COMELEC spokesperson Attorney John Rex Laudianco says they will impose a money ban 5 days before the October 30 polls.
Sa mga susunod na araw po, ilalabas po natin yung resolution kung saan ilalahat po namin yung pagbabawal po na yan, yung tinatawag nating money ban. Pag nakitaan po kayo ng ating pulisya at ang ating AFS Coast Guard na may dala-dala pong 500,000 pesos, pataas at hindi nyo maipaliwanag, hindi nyo masabi kung saan nyo ito gagamitin. Ang assumption po namin dyan, kayo ay mag-engage ng vote buying. Meron pa po iba ito, katulad ng iba na may dala kayong blanco balota, may dala kayong indelible ink, may dala kayong mga acetona na hindi nyo maipaliwanag. Yung po magkukumpulan sa mga bahay ng kandidato, paglabas po, may mga dalang sobre, grocery, ito po ay indikasyon din at ito spring namin na vote buying.
The COMELEC also says the first day of the election period has been smooth and orderly so far.
Hindi naman po namin masasabing magulo, Sir Aljo, no? Ang sinasabi nga po namin maraming tao, pero ganun din po. Kung gano'ng karaming tao, ganun din po karami po ang ating PNP personnel, ang Philippine Coast Guard, pati na rin po ang LGU at kasama ng mga tauhan ng COMELEC. Lahat po kami nagmamanage ngayon. Sa lahat ng napuntahan po namin, ika-apat na po itong Taguig City. Maraming tao, pero wala naman pong gulo. Maayos po ang pinat.
In today's numbers that matter, 411 on National Heroes Day. That's the number of markers across the Philippines commemorating historical figures, according to the National Historical Commission of the Philippines. The ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group says of this figure, 258 are for historic men, while 44 are women. Now, history professor Janet Ragindin Estella says the lower number of monuments for women is a reflection of the general trend in Philippine history, which tends to focus more on men.